name is Joel Emmanuel. I'm from Malaysia. Today, I'm willing to give my testimony and about the shofar and how it impacted my life and so on, and the journey with my shofar. So firstly, I want to tell that how I get to know the shofar. So when I was in my church, there was the service going on in my church, and I didn't know how would the real shofar look like. I didn't know how does a ram's horn does look like. I never seen it before in my life. So this is what it happens in my church, that the service was going on as per normal. Then one day, one of the new church member, one auntie came in the church and she started blowing a shofar. So once she started blowing a shofar, I felt the strong, mighty presence of God filling the church, the atmosphere right away. So that is when I saw the real shofar and how does it look in real life. On how I got an idea on how the Israelites used to blow the shofar and the walls of Jericho fall down. So, and then one day, many problems was going on in my house, and most of the church members know the problem. And all of a sudden, everyone in my house started to get sick and so on. So this new church member who was blowing the shofar, one day she straight away came to my house and she told that, Joel, I think I want you to learn to blow the shofar. So right away, she came to my house and she gave the shofar to me, her shofar, the small ones. She gave it to me and she said, you must learn to blow. So I just accepted what she said, and I started to learn to how to blow the shofar. So she just demonstrated how it is supposed to be blown and so on, the tactics, not for too long. Then I just took a shofar. All in my house, they tried to blow the shofar, but they couldn't blow or create any sound from the shofar. But when I blew, like in 2 minutes, I started to create a sound already, smooth sound from the shofar. So I knew from that the calling of God over my life was to blow the shofar. So I would like to praise and thank God for that. And also, after a few weeks and so on, then I started to get my new shofar from the shofar maker of Malaysia. There happened an event nearby my house. I attended the event there. So this is my new shofar here. This is my new shofar here. So I got it from the shofar maker. So Auntie, can you play the another slide? Yeah, so this is on the day when the event happened. I got my new shofar and they anointed me on my first shofar. This is what happened. From then onwards, the Lord started filling me. The Lord started using me mightily and so on, and many things more. And then I started to also blow shofar in my school. Normally in the government school, they doesn't allow to bring the shofar to school, because it is because of the Malay school. So they won't allow all the Christian fellowship and so on. But I got a very great chance to bring the shofar in the school and to blow and to conduct a Christian fellowship in my school. It was such a great thing that God allowed it. Yeah, it was a very great plan of God. So then all the teachers in the schools and all my students there, all my friends, they testified saying that when I blew the shofar, the presence of God started filling the place, filling the atmosphere, and even the teachers there said that it is very new to them that they hearing the sound of the shofar. So they said that, Joel, I think one day you should come to our church or come to our house to sound the shofar, because we believe that when you sounded the shofar, there was a breakthrough over the school, over the atmosphere, and so on. So that's all, and then I would like to praise and thank God and so on. It also affected surrounding all the people all around in my church. When I blew and created a short sound, it was kind of not very well and so on. But in few weeks, I started learning and started attending many congresses and concerts all over Malaysia. So then the Lord started to use mightily and so on. That's all for today. Thank you.
What a blessing it is that you are to the body, Joel, and a real blessing to hear your testimony today and to see how the Lord's going to, and is using you mightily. And there's a special anointing for those that blow the shofars. I know that because it's very difficult for other people. So I lead a prayer for Israel, and there's a shofarist in that. And he's self-taught by the Holy Spirit. He's an elderly man. He turns 80 this year. So he would be so thrilled to know about your journey. So you're starting at the other spectrum of the scale. So thank you so much for sharing. God bless you. Now, I would like to welcome you, David, if you'd like to open with prayer for us, please, and bring the announcements.
Hallelujah. Thank you very much, Sister Allison, for being our chairperson today. And thank you, Brother Joel from Malaysia, for the powerful testimony. And I'm just so happy that we all now can come together, you know, as a family of God and learn the best of ministry from one another. As iron sharpens iron, so we become sharper, whether we sharpen each other through shofar, to word, to teaching, to preaching. I think it is a blessing that God's kingdom, and that we are all being so kingdom-minded, you know, regardless of the church that we come from. And by all means, Joel, continue to sound the shofar here and everywhere else. And I think it is such a unique thing that shofar is being sounded in schools in Malaysia. Certainly, we would love to see that in Perth as well. Hallelujah. Let us all pray today as we start the meeting, and then I'll do the announcement and hand it back to Allison and Paul. Hallelujah. Father, we just want to thank you today, Lord. Indeed, Lord, at your sound and by your word, Father God, the world and the heavens were made. Father, we just want to invite your spirit, Father God, today to be with us, Father God. We do not want information. We want transformation. We do not want a mental stimulation. We want the Holy Spirit invasion. So, Father God, today, as Brother Paul teach part 3 of As in the Days of Noah, Father, we just pray, Father, that our spirit man will awaken. That, Father God, that you do a deeper thing in us and deep call upon deep, Father God, that we continue to learn from you, learn of you, and abide in you, Father God, that our life, our spirit man will be refreshed, recharged, energized, Father God, and prepared and alert and stimulated to understand the signs of the times, that we will not be blur, we will not be confused, nor we be deterred by the works of the enemy, but that we will know and discern the times as the sons of Issachar in the Old Testament. So we give you thanks, Abba Father, for your presence here, wherever we are, on Zoom, via Zoom, through the different people across the different places that are joining us today. In the mighty name of Yeshua, we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Just have a very quick announcement, and then we will hand over the time to Allison and hand over the time to Paul. We do have, because actually later I'll be sharing another Messianic meeting in Malaysia at 3:40. So I just want to center myself and cool myself down. Next week, we will have a very interesting part 2. Remember, a few weeks ago, I talked about the loveliness of Yeshua, timeless object lessons from the tabernacle of Moses. We talk about the courtyard and the structure. Well, next week is part 2. And Sister Miriam will be bringing a very, very exciting, the tabernacle, the colors and materials used in the tabernacle. Again, it all points to the loveliness of Yeshua and his finished work on the cross. If we can't find that, it's all information. But if we can find that, it becomes a transformational thing that brings insight and deepen our walk with God. So please do not miss next week, 2 to 3:30. Sister Miriam, who is one of our heads of the Messianic Ministries in Perth, she will be bringing us part 2, the colors and materials used in the tabernacle. She'll also be back to talk about the showbread. She'll also be back to talk about the altar of incense. And then I believe Paul, Miriam, and myself will jointly talk about the Holy of Holies. And I'll be dealing with the altar of burnt offering as well as the menorah. So watch out. I'll see you next Tuesday. But I thought last week was a beautiful time. How many of you were with us last week? Put up a show of hands. How many of you were with us face to face? Yay! Yes, face to face and by Zoom. That's very good. And we had a great time last week. So I thought I will actually do a little bit of a synopsis sharing of what happened last week, so that for those of us who missed it, you can join in the fun. One, two, right. Face-to-face meeting, and we celebrated Sister Deidre's 80th birthday. That's really awesome. So we're going to have another face-to-face meeting in July. We'll keep you posted. But certainly, if you have a 50th, 60th, 70th, and 80th birthday, just let us know. Bring your cake. We'll be all there with all our all ears and all mouth to enjoy your birthday cake. Okay? Hallelujah. Back to you, Alison.
Okay, thank you, Dave, and all the best for this afternoon. The Holy Spirit really rests on you mightily.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Have a good, peaceful time before then. Just like to welcome Paul up to speak. Well, not up to speak, but to present his message. If you'd like to unmute yourself, Paul, we're all eager to hear. Thank you.
Thanks, Alison. Thanks for the introduction. And yes, David, we pray that your teaching this afternoon goes well and the Spirit moves you to speak.
Thanks, Paul.
His truth. Thank you, Father. We pray that today that what I speak is not of me and is of the Spirit of God. I'm talking about the days of Noah part 3, and I really want to put this to bed now and finish up with the days of Noah. And what I might do is just share my screen so that you can see my slide where we got up to last time. And just bear with me while I do that. And we can then move forward. And hang on, here we go. And we just want to share that. Okay. So can you see my slide on the screen? Just give me a thumbs up if you can see it. I can see Margaret going okay. And I'll just change the position here. And can you see that on the screen? Shema Israel, can you see that? Let's say it together. Do you want to unmute yourselves? And it's a nice small group today, and we can say it together. Ready? Hear, O Israel,
the Lord our God, the Lord is one.
You shall love the
Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and with all your mind.
command you shall be on your heart.
You shall teach them diligently to your children.
Last couple of weeks ago, when we spoke about the days of Noah, I had something similar that you can see up on the screen. You can see the drawing that I wrote on my board. I've kind of translated that onto a PowerPoint presentation, and this is where we ended up. I don't know where we're getting that. Yes.
Could I ask people to unmute to mute yourself, please? Thank you.
That's great. And can everyone just give me a thumbs up? You can see the diagram on the screen, the 7 years, the 3.5. Everyone can see that? Great.
Thanks. Very well.
Ken, very small.
Sorry?
Very small, because you've got two slides on the screen.
Have I got two slides? Let me just see if I can stop that. Let's go back here.
Yeah,
this is better. Much better.
Okay, what can you see now?
We could see nothing now, but we could see that we've actually listed all the slides.
Oh, no. Okay, sorry. You were in the wrong area. Let me just flick it over to that. And let me just share that.
Just now was good, Paul. We could see one nice big slide.
Oh, you could?
Yes.
Okay. Let me just bring that on. How about that?
Yay. Perfect.
Is that better?
Yay.
Okay. Yes, it's better. Thank you.
Okay. That's good. So you can see this is where we ended up. And we had the diagram showing Yeshua coming, rapturing us up. And we're coming back into the millennial kingdom. And when I went to part three, I thought, where can we go from here? And there's a very important thing that happens, and it's happening right now in the heavenly realm, and that's worship. Our God has been worshipped continually, and we are designed to worship Him. So when we join with Him in the New Jerusalem, we're going to be worshiping Him daily. And how does that relate to what we're doing now? What is the purpose of worship? Why do we do it? And if it's something that's going to happen in the kingdom, it's something that we need to understand about how it applies to our lives right now. So that's where I thought I would take it today, is we would end with the days of Noah, understanding what worship is, having a look at a biblical view of worship, because there's all kinds of weird stuff happening around about worship, and how it applies to us, and what can it actually achieve in our lives here, because we're in this area here, we're in this birth pains area, and the intense persecution is starting to ramp up for the Christian church. So we're not actually in the kingdom yet, that's still to come, but we know that in the kingdom there is worship. When we go to the book of Revelation, I hope you've all got your Bibles, because you know I like it when you've got your Bibles. If you go to your Bible to the book of Revelation and chapter 4, go to Revelation chapter 4. And it talks about what's happening in the heavenly realm. And it talks about this holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of heaven's armies, the one who was, who is, and who is coming. So there's these beings are worshiping God in the heavenly realm continually. And when we come to worship God, we need to understand that we are joining in with this worship that is continually happening in the heavenly realm. But we need to have an understanding of what it means and what are the outcomes of this worship that's happening. So if we have a look at Revelation chapter 4 and we go to verse 6, it says, in the front of the throne was what looked like a sea of glass. And when the sea is represented as glass, it represents stability. When we see the waves are churning and it's rough, it means instability. So we're in a place of stability because the sea is glass and clear as crystal. In the center around the throne were four living beings, covered with eyes in front and behind. The first living being was like a lion. The second living being was an ox. The third living being had a face that looked human. And the fourth being was like a flying eagle. Each of the four beings had six wings and was covered with eyes inside and out. And day and night, they never stop saying. So this is what I'm saying. In the heavenly realm, God has been worshipped continuing. Day and night, they never stop saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, the one who was, the one who is, and who is coming. And whenever the living beings give glory, honor, and thanks to the one sitting on the throne, the one who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before the one sitting on the throne who lives forever and ever and worship him. They throw their crowns, they throw their deeds in front of the throne and say, you are worthy, Lord God. You have glory, honor, and power because you created all things. Yes, because of your will, they were created and became into being. So that's where I think I'll start today, is let's take this idea of worship and let's take it further and get a deeper understanding of what worship means for us now in this age and in the age to come. We need to understand what it's all about. Is everybody with me? Give me a thumbs up. It's gone very quiet. Very good. So what we need to understand about worship, and you may not have known this before, that worship is actually a weapon, and the enemy is defeated by worship. We heard the testimony of Joel this afternoon about him blowing his shofar and the change that happened when he learned to do that. There was a change in the spirit, and he testified to that. The same thing with worship. When we worship correctly in spirit and in truth, the enemy will be defeated. When we have our victory, we're in the kingdom, and in the kingdom there is worship. We also need to understand that we need to respond to the work of Yeshua. The work of Yeshua enables us to worship. And we need to see the context of redemption and worship. They work together. You can't be outside of redemption and worship the God of Israel. There will be no power and authority through the worship. Godly worship can only be done in the context of redemption. Who can tell me? You might have to unmute. Where redemption is spoken of in the Bible. If you're maybe Jewish, you may have an understanding of it because there's a book that's about redemption in the Bible. Does anyone know where we learn about redemption?
Book of Hebrews.
Book of Hebrews has a lot about redemption in, but if you speak to a Jewish person, there's a book called the Book of Redemption, otherwise known as Exodus. The Book of Exodus speaks of redemption. We know when we go to the Exodus chapter 12, we learn about Passover and the work that was done. You can see on my slide, I've got Exodus chapter 5, verse 1. Grab your Bibles and go there. Very important that you do, because Exodus is known as the Book of Redemption. We can't worship correctly outside of redemption. Redemption is critical, important to understand. And if we go to that chapter 5, verse 1, it says, after that, in fact, I might go back up to the end of verse 4, chapter 4, verse 29. And it says, then Moses and Aaron went and gathered together all the leaders of the people of Israel. Aaron said everything the Lord had told Moses, who then performed the signs for the people to see. The people believed when they heard that the Lord had remembered the people of Israel and seen how they were oppressed. They bowed their heads and worshipped. And you see, this is connection between worship and redemption. Chapter 5, very important, verse 1. After that, Moses and Aaron came and said to Pharaoh, is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. And if your Bible says, let my people go, scrub the word let out. The word is send forth. Send forth my people so that they can, what? Celebrate a festival in the desert to honor me. So they can celebrate a festival in the desert to honor me. But Pharaoh
You're dropping out. Can't hear you.
We can't hear you.
Yeah, we lost you for a while, Paul.
Where did I go? Where should I start?
Back up and stand out. Stand forth.
Let my people go.
Okay, let my people go. So if your Bible says, let my people go, it's not let, it's send forth. You need to send my people. So letting is different to sending. So send forth my people so that they can celebrate a festival in the desert to honor me. Pharaoh replied, who is the Lord that I should obey when he says, send forth Israel? I don't know the Lord, and I also won't let Israel go. They said, the God of the Hebrews has met with us. Please let us go 3 days' journey into the desert so that we can sacrifice to the Lord. You need to make this connection between celebrating a festival and sacrifice. So we're understanding, we're starting to get an idea of what worship is about. There's a requirement for celebration, happiness, and sacrifice coming together. And the Lord wanted them to come out of the world, come out of Egypt, come out of Pharaoh's land, go into the wilderness, which is dependence on him, so that you can celebrate and sacrifice. Okay, so juggle that ball. Understand that concept. If I drop out again, just give me a sign so that I know to go over it again. So Exodus 5:1. After that, Moses and Aaron came and said to Pharaoh, here is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Send forth my people so that they can celebrate a festival in the desert. So God wants us to be with him, to worship with him. This is a pattern for the kingdom. He wants us to come and join with him, patterned in the book of Exodus. We learn that worship is a supernatural response, right? And that is why we were created. If we go to the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 27, it says, so God created humankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created a male and female. He created them. If we're built in the image of God, we need to worship him to manifest his glory. We need to see that connection. We are of his image, and we manifest his glory by worshiping. worship will manifest his glory to bring change, a kingdom change. And that's where we go back to this original diagram, kingdom. We need to understand the ultimate goal is, that's what redemption is to bring you in with God. Worship will manifest his glory to bring change, a kingdom change. And we see that in Zechariah chapter 14, verse 7, and one day known to the Lord will be neither day nor night, although by evening there will be light. So we know that this has kingdom connotations. The kingdom is coming. It will not need the light of the sun or the moon. So today, this is where we're going to get started. This is where we're going to go through and analyze a piece of text to get a really good understanding about what worship is and what it does. And then after this, we're going to worship God. And we might worship him in a different light, knowing what worship can accomplish. Right? So grab your Bibles again. Go to the back, Revelation chapter 15. In there myself. So Revelation chapter 15 shows a vision in the heavenly realm again, where worship in the context of redemption brings destruction on the enemy. And wouldn't we like to see destruction of the enemy? We want to see the enemy destroyed. And we need to know how to do that through the worship of our God. We know that through redemption we have victory, and we need to understand how that all works together. God and the song of the Lamb.
It's gone again. Can't hear you.
Okay, I'm waiting. Have I come back?
Yes, you're back, Paul.
Okay. We might be having problems with my internet, so I might just put us onto the phone. Hang on a second. Because this has happened a few times now, hasn't it?
The enemy needs to be defeated.
Amen.
The enemy doesn't want you to hear this.
That's right.
Yes.
The enemy wants you to go.
We need to blow the shofar right now.
That is enemies being scattered.
We need Joel with his shofar.
Yes. Yes. Glory.
Hang on a second.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Well done, Judy. Well done.
Well done, Judy.
I'm going to connect to the Wi-Fi. I might drop off. Hold on a second. How's that?
And we can hear you. Very good, Paul.
Okay. I've changed connection and I'm using my phone. So maybe that might be better.
We can hear you, we can see you, and we can see the PowerPoint slides, Revelation 15. There we go. Hallelujah.
Okay. So what we need to do is just go through this verse very carefully. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to also bring up another. See that one. I find when I'm working in Zoom, the computer just doesn't work as expected. I've got all kinds of weird things happening. So let's just put that out the way. Aha, that's good. And so Revelation chapter 15, verse 3, and they sing the song of Moses. And you notice that the word sing is actually in the present tense, which means it's continuing on, right? They sing the song of Moses, the servant of God. We know that Moses is the servant in God, and the song of the Lamb. Can you see the connection between Moses, our first redeemer, and Yeshua, the Lamb. They come together in the context of redemption. Moses, I've already spoken to you in Exodus chapter 5 about Moses was asked to bring the people out to worship the Lord in the wilderness, Exodus chapter 5. The song of Moses is actually in Deuteronomy chapter 32. You can go ahead. We don't have time to do that today, but you might want to just take a picture of the slide and go back in your own time and go through the song of Moses from Deuteronomy 32. Moses also sings a song of deliverance in Exodus 15, which David echoes as well. But there are a few songs that we can go through in more depth, which we don't really have time to today. But what we're saying here is we're connecting the song of Moses and the song of the Lamb together, the song of the Lamb redemption. We know that the book of Exodus is the book of redemption. So let's understand that. Let me just go through to the next slide. Deuteronomy 18:15 tells us that Moses is the first redeemer and Yeshua is the second. Verse 3, carrying on, great and marvelous are your works, Lord God Almighty. The Lord God Almighty means the one who seizes everything. Exodus 6:2 speaks about the name of God being revealed as being transcendent. David will tell you about the name Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, Yehovah, I am that I am, I will be that I want to be.
Amen.
Do you have something to say on that, David?
Next week.
Once he start, he cannot stop.
My internet is not that clear today.
Am I breaking up or were you?
No, my internet, my internal internet, my mental internet. I'll be very quiet today.
You're just a bit nervous for your teaching this afternoon.
I know, mankind multitask.
No, I understand. So they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are your works. Lord God Almighty, just and true are the ways of thou King of saints. And we know that the saints talks about sacred and holy. We are which is spoken about in this chapter, verse 3. Verse 4 says, who shall not fear thee, O Lord, and glorify thy name? For thou art holy, for all nations shall come and worship before thee, for thy judgments are made manifest. Let me just catch up my slideshow because I'm going off on another area before I get there. So I've got a couple questions for you. Are there things in your life that are not under his domain or does not reflect his authority? We need to understand that God moves in the midst of worship to destroy the enemy. So ask yourself those things. Are there things in your life that are not under his domain or does not reflect his authority? We need to understand within worship that the work of the enemy can be destroyed. Verse 3, just and true are your ways, Lord. I want your ways, not compromise the truth. This is what we're talking about. Just and true are your ways. Our King of saints, we become holy by means of redemption. Remember the famous verse in 1 Peter 2, 9. We are a holy people, a holy convocation. Kingdom worship brings about change. And the book of Romans is great about talking about change. Romans chapter 12, 1 to 2, be renewed by the renewing of your mind. So let's just have a look at that. I'm having real problems with my computer today. I don't know what's going on. I'm fighting with it a bit. Yeah, I'm getting some really bad lagging happening here, so just bear with me as I try to pull all the levers. So I'm just going to the book of Romans chapter 12. You can do the same in your Bible. And I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what that is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Can you hear me? It's gone all quiet over there.
It's loud and clear, Paul.
We are all muted.
We're all muted. That's why we're quiet. We can't talk. We're muted.
Okay, sorry. I'm just having some real computer problems on this side today. I don't know what's going on. I'm sure the enemy doesn't want me to be speaking about this today.
The enemy is defeated. He's under our feet.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you. I'll carry on because once we get this, it's going to be great. Verse 4, who shall not fear thee, O Lord, and glorify thy name? For thou only art holy, for all nations shall come and worship before thee, for thy judgments are made manifest. So this talks about don't replace your priorities with God's. So how often we do that is we are told two great commandments. Remember what they are? You're to love the Lord your God and love your neighbor as yourself. And we're also told, seek first the kingdom and my righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. We hear that. But do we actually put it into practice? And do we actually respond to it? Right? So, who shall not fear the Lord and glorify his name? For he only is holy. For all nations shall come and worship before you. For your judgments are made manifest. Do not replace your priorities with God. Holy, holy, holy. We started with that in Isaiah chapter 6, Revelation chapter 4. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Kodesh, Kodesh, Kodesh. And when we read it in the book of Isaiah, we see that later on Isaiah says, woe is me when he heard this. He says, I have unclean lips. Do you remember that? In Isaiah chapter 6, woe is me. Holy, in this instance, is talking about pious. And pious is like an old English word that's not used much. But when we look at its meaning, it's quite interesting that you are holy, Lord. Pious means obsessed in every detail. God is obsessed in every detail of our life, every little detail. And so what we've got to watch is that we go back to those two main commandments again. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. And then everything else falls in place from that. And sometimes we can lose focus and we focus on other things other than God himself. God is obsessed with every detail. When we look at the book of Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 10, it says, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love. He remembers everything we do. Then in the next couple of weeks, David and Miriam are going to be teaching about the tabernacle. And when we learn about the tabernacle, we learn about how precise God is about everything, down to the color, the measurements, the meaning, the requirements. So we need to understand that God is holy, pious, obsessed with every detail. We need to understand that these things will be realized in the kingdom. We call out, Lord, come, come, Yeshua, come, Maranatha. So this passage is speaking about change. There's going to be a change. Are we ready for this change that is coming, this kingdom to come? Are we ready for it? As in, do we focus on the Lord our God, or do we have idols and things which distract us from that? Seek first the kingdom of God and my righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. I just have a think about that. When you worship God, are these the things you're taking into consideration? Do you know that he is a holy God and he is meticulous for every little detail in our life? Does, when you worship, do you defeat the enemy? Is the enemy defeated in your worship, like when Joel blows that shofar? Verse 5. And after that, I looked up, and behold, the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven was opened. Isn't that amazing? So when we say the Lord's Prayer, it says, Our Father who art in heaven, and will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We know that if you've watched me before, I get on the board and I draw the reflection between what's happening in the heavenly realm or what the pattern that happens in the earthly realm. We know that there is a tabernacle in heaven as well as the one that was created here on earth under the ownership of the Levitical priesthood. Let's read that again. After that, I looked up, and behold, the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven was opened. So what happened before this? There was the angels worshiping, singing what? The song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. After they were doing this, what happened? The testimony of the ark in heaven opened. This is important to understand the order of things that happened. There was worship, and then after worship, the ark of the testimony opened. And the seven angels came out of the temple having the seven plagues. We know what the seven plagues are. The seven plagues are about to unleash judgment, right? So what did we have? We'll go over that again. The angels were singing the song of Moses, the song of the Lamb, and pop, our God is holy. The temple of the Ark of the Testimony opened, and seven angels came out with the judgment of God. We need to see this. It's very important. Worship, glorifying God for his judgments opened up and releases the angels. We have to get rid of the garbage before he comes. We have to get rid of all the stuff that we prioritize in our life that we think is important. We need to understand that worship has a... Verse 6 says, clothed in pure and white linen, having their breasts girded with golden girdles. What ancient old English that is, to be girded in the biblical sense is to be prepared for service. Do you remember when Yeshua washed the feet of his disciples? He girded himself with his belt and he prepared himself for service. When we go to the book of Ephesians, we know that the old English there is gird yourself with the belt of truth. Prepare yourself for service, right? And one of the four beasts gave unto the seven angels seven golden vials full of the wrath of God, who liveth forever and ever. So you can see that this worship has exposed who God is. He is holy, he is just, he is true. And the testimony was open and God's wrath came out. After God's wrath comes our victory. So let's go through some things in conclusion to this. Can you all hear me still? Give me a thumbs up. Brilliant. Excellent. So some things we can look at in the spirit of worship. God says yes. When we understand what redemption is and what it brings about, worshiping in spirit and truth, God releases angels to go into battle. We may be soldiers. We've girded ourselves with the belt of truth and we've got the breastplate of righteousness, the sword of the spirit, but we're not in the front line. Worship releases the angels that release God's judgment. So I want you to have another view of what worship does, right? Releases those angels into work for us. When the plagues are over, when we go through the book of Revelation through 15, 16, 17, we see that in chapter 19, it talks about the wedding with the bridegroom. The church comes together with Yeshua. When the plagues are over, the wedding comes. We know that wedding signifies joy, victory. Yeah. So when we go to Revelation chapter 19, we see that the wedding happens after the judgment has gone out. It says there in Revelation 19, verse 7, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and his wife hath made herself ready. The wife is the bride of Christ. And to her was granted that we should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. Can you see the context of worship and the result of came victory? So I don't know if you've understood or previously that this is what worship is about. So when you worship, do you expect a heavenly response? I can see Margaret's going, yes.
Yes.
The heavenly response. The angels will go forth and the enemy will bow and be destroyed. Are you ready, willing, and able to respond?
Yes.
Ready. Amen. This is lordship demonstrated in your life. Love the Lord your God with all your soul, heart, mind. Love the Lord and love your neighbor as yourself. Seek first the kingdom and my righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. Has the enemy built a stronghold in your life? And maybe that's why it has, because you don't know the power of what worship is about. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Does anyone have any questions before we go to a time of worship? Because
I have a question, Paul.
Yes, who's speaking?
May I ask you, you mentioned about the four creatures, four beasts.
Yes.
What could they be? What are they?
Say again?
The four living creatures, yeah.
Yes. What did you want to know?
The four living creatures, one has got a human face and the other the lion and the rest something else. What does it resemble in during that time? Who are they? And, you know, some refer them to as four beasts or four living creatures. I get a bit confused.
Yes. So that's spoken about in the book of Ezekiel and also understood in the book of Daniel. And it's talking about the animals representing certain things. For example, the lion could be representing glory, and the ox power, man intelligence, and eagle supernatural. So these are beings in the heavenly realm that are not only to be represented by the animals, but also what the animal actually means. So,
okay.
If you think of a lion, you think of glory, lion and the lamb. Ox is power. Man, intelligence, eagle, supernatural. So, as on the wings of eagles, whenever we see the representation of an eagle, we think supernatural. This is a supernatural power that is happening. But for the purpose of today, it's just about understanding that whenever we start to worship, we're actually not starting worship, we're joining in with worship that's continually going in the heavenly realm. And we know that this worship is going to unleash the wrath and to give us victory.
Can I make a statement rather than a question and you can add to it?
Thank you.
Worship really, as far, you know, like with music, is obviously worship to the Lord, but we worship with our lifestyle as well. So would you like to elaborate on that at all?
Yes. So when I talk about worship, I'm not necessarily just talking about singing songs. I remember when we began in Exodus chapter 5, verse 1, and God said, send forth my people out of this place so that you can celebrate a festival with me. If we drop down to verse 3, it also talks about so that you can sacrifice to me. And we can tie that in with Romans chapter 12, where it says, you know, you need your life to be a living sacrifice. And so we're joining worship with sacrifice and celebration. It's a lot more than just singing songs, right? As how we understand worship to be. And I kept going on about the two commandments, love the Lord your God, as you love your neighbor as yourself. If we can just focus in on him, then everything else falls into place. And I think sometimes we can miss that and we can bring things ahead of that. And that's why I was asking the question about, God our Lord? Savior, but is he our Lord as well? Lord and Savior. Yeah. Any other questions?
Yeah, Paul. This is John here.
I can see you, John. How are you? I can't hear you. Can anyone hear John? You're muted.
John, can you unmute yourself?
Sorry. I had a question on a few slides earlier where the heading was Revelation 15.
Mm.
And your second point was, do not replace your priorities.
Yes.
The second pointer, do not replace your priorities with God's. I wasn't quite clear on that.
So an example of that is our priorities might be our job, or our children, or our wife. And suddenly we build an idol of that, right? When we read verse 4, it says, who shall not fear the Lord, fear you, O Lord, and glorify your name? Yeah. So often we read this and we go, oh, yes, of course, you know, Lord, you are number one. But when we put it in our culture and our terminology and say, hey, don't replace your priorities with God's. God has a priority, and his priority is redemption so that we can be with him. That's his priority. So often we can go off and say, no, I understand that, but, right? I'm talking for myself as well,
because
it's very easy to move into something that moves us off what God's plan is. I often speak of, you know, we're almost on a ship that's heading towards, all of us in this world are on the same ship heading towards a waterfall. And God is taking us through to the end of the world, whether we like it or not.
Wow.
Whether we're good at our job or we're good at soccer or whatever sport we do. It's almost like shuffling deck chairs on the Titanic, because the kingdom will be established.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. And whether we're ready for it or not. So I'm saying, please, are we ready? Are we putting God a priority in our life? Mm. Or are our priorities more important?
Yes, the challenging question. Are we ready? Yeah.
Very Thank good. You, Paul.
We have to be ready, no matter what.
Hallelujah.
Absolutely.
I think I'm ready to share a sentence. I think just getting myself pumped up for the next one.
Come on, David.
Thank you for being my very good audience. You know, in the Old Testament, we were so fixated on purification, ceremonial purification, as well as the system of sacrifices. You know, the bulls, the birds, the turtle horns, the pigeons, you know, and so on, you know, and those were the offerings in the tabernacle on the altar of burnt offering. But, you know, in the New Testament, thank God, if you read that the whole entire book of Hebrew, it says that therefore Jesus, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered outside the gate. So let us go forth to him outside the camp, bearing his reproach. For here we have no continuing city. So we always think about God's kingdom. And this is the kicker. It says, therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifice of our praise.
Praise.
So in the Old Testament, we were so fixated about the system of sacrifices. But Christ, Yeshua, the perfect sacrifice, he came and obliterated the whole entire system of sacrifices. No more red heifer, no more, goats and rams and horns and bulls and everything. But now we have a new sacrifice. And the sacrifice that we have continually is the sacrifice of praise unto God. That is the first fruit of our lips, sapar, giving thanks to his name, but do not forget to do good and to share, for with such sacrifice God is well pleased.
Amen. Yes, David, praise and worship. Amen. The sacrifice now is praise and worship, right?
Yeah. Yes, and also to do good unto others, and also to remember the
yes. kingdom.
So what was yes. over is the system Amen. Of animal sacrifice. But today it's not the animal that God is after, but God is after our heart. God is after the circumcision of our heart, and God is after our heartbeat must align with his heartbeat, and our spirit have aligned with his spirit. Therefore, whatever comes up from our heart is a reflection. Whatever comes up from our mouth is a reflection of our heart and our Amen. Mind, giving thanks and glory to the Father. Over to you, Paul.
Amen. Yeah. So I think it's probably time to sing a song, don't you? Shall we praise the Lord? And maybe with a different
yes,
mindset yes. this time, so we can praise him, understanding that we're going to release and we're going to expect change in the heavenly realm.
Release the negative thoughts, yeah,
and the enemy will be defeated.
Yeah.
So let me just stop the share if I can. I'm just having a battle with my computer. Oh, here we go. There we go. And I'll just take that out the way. No, not yet. And I'm just going to bring up my worship song that we can do today. We might. What time did you want to finish, David?
Ding.
3:30.
3:30. Okay, that's good.
3:30, if it's okay.
Yes, that's fine.
Cool.
And I'm just going to share the sound as well. I'm really having a nightmare with my computer today. I don't know what's going on. Share computer sound. There you go. And I'm going to move that across. So can you say that, can you see my web browser?
Yep.
Okay. And this song that we're going to start off with is not new, but it's an old hymn.
Amen.
Which I really like, and you'll see the words
yes.
of him, and then we'll go into the next song. So I'll start this up.
Hell soul and sing of him who died for me. Inhale him as thy matchless king through all eternity.
One more song.
Kings and kingdoms will bow down.
stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Thank you, Father. Thank you for this time that we've had together. Thank you for your word on your worship, Father. And we thank you that your worship opens up your power and authority over the heavenly realm and over this earthly realm, Father. As it is in heaven, as it is on earth, may it be done in heaven. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Paul. That was wonderful, a wonderful teaching. You're very gifted with your teaching. We get so much out of it. So thank you so much. And just as a reminder to everybody, about next week at 2 o'clock, zoom in to hear part two of The Loveliness of Yeshua with Miriam. And she's speaking on, again, as a reminder, the tabernacle, its colours and materials that are used in the tabernacle. So we'll all look forward to that. So now back to you, Paul, for the benediction, if that's okay. Thank you.
Yes, no problem at all.
Wait, just one more reminder. So for those that may be doing the TAV Teach Hebrew classes, class number 5 is on tomorrow night. 7:30 for those that are coming in from Australia and other times, I'm sure the different nations know. So thank you for that as well.
Thanks, Alison. So before we go, it says, verse 22, the Lord said to Moses, speak to Aaron and his sons and tell them that this is how you are to bless the people of Israel. You are to say to them, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and show you his favor. May the Lord lift up his face toward you and give you peace. In this way, they are to put my name on the people of Israel so that I will bless them. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Judy.
Bless you. Thank you. Thank you. Bless you.
God bless you too. If there's any other shofars there that would like to blow, here's your opportunity.
I'm sure after today, everyone will be going and trying to get a shofar and do what Brother Joe
does. Sister Shalom. Where is she?
Sister Shalom.
Yes, I'm going to blow now.
Yay! Thank you.
God bless you.
God bless you too, Shalom.
Go to you and bless your people. Bless all your children, Lord. Amen. And what Joel also blew. And thank you, Lord, for the shofar. Bless you, Lord. In Yeshua's name.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for
Thank you, David.
Coming. Thank you, Bob and Kay. I hope you saw yourself just now.
Thank you.
Beautiful people. Thank you, Allison, for the chairing today's meeting. Thank you, Delise. How are you? Looking good. No more tummy aches.
Hey, Shalom.
Hi, Paul. Thank you so much. And Judy. Thank you, Pastor Danny. Hey. Margaret Whitley. Dr. Sean, Susie, Charity, May, Sister Shalom. Brother Sharon Tan, Sister Sharon Tan and Brother something. Janet Carson, Elaine, you're back. You're transported from your car back home.
Oh, yeah.
That is so funky. We should have more people driving in a car. Don't hold your phone, drive and listen in, okay? Just have someone holding. That was good. That was good. You were driving and then communicating with us. That was awesome. And thank you,
Alice,
Tracy, Sarah,
Danny,
good to see your friend Elaine. Good to see your friend Elaine. What's the name?
Mercy,
my friend. This is me.
Hi. Zoom to tomorrow for the rest. And see you next week. I'll be with Charity. And have a good day. Thanks for.
Thank you.